Thank you very much. Thank you. Today we're going to fix you a special breakfast in bed. The morning after the night before. Imagine, if you will, it's Saturday morning about noon. You gently nudge your sweetheart. She wakes up and she sees you with a seductive smile, a tray with champagne and goodies, and of course you're wearing only an apron. It's gonna be a good day. Today I have three menu suggestions for you, but you may not want to fix them all. It just depends on what kind of a mood you are and how frisky you're feeling that day. And you know, when you're in the mood, you're in the mood. I have a hot, airy cheese souffle. I have my version, a seafood version of Eggs Benedict. Ooh, that hollandaise sauce. And we have an apple and roquefort tart, which was inspired by a trip to France that I took not that long ago. So I hope you enjoy these. It's gonna be a wonderful meal, and your sweetheart is gonna fall in love with you all over again. But again, I must give you a warning when you prepare a romantic brunch for someone. I must tell you about two students I had, a young woman who married, shall I say, a more mature gentleman. And every Sunday morning, he would fix her brunch. And afterwards, they'd make love to the sound of the church bells. Ding, dong, ding, dong. And you know, he'd still be here with us today if that darn fire truck hadn't gone by. Our first dish is a soufflé au fromage, a cheese soufflé. Ladies and gentlemen, don't worry, it's not difficult. Most of it is prepared ahead. Hey, after all, you've won that gorgeous person sitting next to you, so don't be intimidated by a soufflé. They're really not that hard to make. Let me just show you how to do it. First of all, we're gonna need some egg whites. We're gonna need some bechamel. Bechamel is a base sauce used throughout the repertoire de la French cuisine for gratins and savory soufflés. In order to make it, we are going to make a roux first, which is butter and flour. All right, I'm gonna put about 4 ounces of butter. Audience, what's wrong with butter?
Nothing.
Absolutely not. We're gonna put 4 ounces of butter. Put that over there. Melt the butter to make our roux. Then we're gonna add about 6 ounces of flour and about a cup and a half of milk, and just boil it. I'm gonna show you how to do it here very quickly. Season it with a little salt and pepper and nutmeg, and you have your basic savory souffle. You can use any kind of cheese. I'm gonna use my favorite, which is Gruyere, but you could use goat cheese. You could do a Roquefort or a blue cheese, you certainly could, or a cheddar. And they all have great results with these. And don't be concerned about slamming the oven door. You know, always say you gotta kinda creep up and open the oven door and very gently close it. Well, here sometimes we make 100 souffles and the door is being jammed all the time. If you do it right, you won't have any problems. Now, let me just finish the roux here. So we're gonna take our, again, butter and flour. Make your roux, cook it a little bit. Be careful not to scorch it. I'm gonna do it in a little bit of speed up time here. Once that's ready to go, we're gonna put our milk, again, about a cup and a half. This'll make two nice souffles. Season it with a little bit of nutmeg, a pinch. A little bit of salt and pepper. There you are. And we'll let that cook 2 or 3 minutes and it'll thicken up. Now, as it's TV time and we have to move along, I have made a little bit of bechamel ahead of time. Now, I'm gonna show you the cheese, my favorite cheese, Gruyere. Right, and this is just a less than a quarter wheel. You know, in Switzerland, they have an old tradition where when a girl is born, they take a whole wheel of Gruyere, put it into a cave, or a storage area. And, of course, the story goes 18 years later. It doesn't work that way anymore. Now it's 40 years later. For the wedding ceremony, they bring the cheese out, and it is part of the wedding feast. I think that's a nice little...
Will it last long enough for a second marriage?
Well, I guess if you don't eat it all for the first marriage. Let's make our souffle here. We're going to take 4 egg whites, put it in the mixer, a pinch of salt, and just whip up those egg whites. Now, this is all made ahead. You could even make it the day before, but make sure it comes back to room temperature before you do it. We're going to whip the egg whites into just a soft peaks. Okay. It'll take 1 minute. You have this prepared ahead. You have your cheese ready to go, and you whip your egg whites. Of course, you need a preheated 375-degree oven. All right. They're ready to go. That really didn't take that long. I just want to show you how it's supposed to look. You don't want to over-whip them. Just like that. Very easy to do. Let me put this out of the way over here. And we're just going to fold the whipped egg whites into the bechamel. You put the cheese first, you put the cheese after. It really doesn't make any difference. Let's put that in there. Again, 4 egg whites. We're also going to put 4 egg yolks and mix it together right here. And then the Gruyere cheese, or whichever cheese you want to have, we'll put it inside. You need about 6 or 8 ounces, depending on the cheese. And be careful, some of the cheeses are saltier than others. So it pays to maybe take it easy on the salt first and taste it a little bit and just be aware of what kind of cheese you're doing. Once your batter is ready, and it might pay to have this done first, but you know, it'll stay there for a few minutes, not a big deal. We're gonna take some butter. Yay. Nothing wrong with that, right? We're gonna take a little melted butter and very carefully butter the inside of a souffle mold. All the souffles, whether they're sweet or savory or done this way. And make sure you very well get around the lip here, because otherwise your souffle will stick and be lopsided, like the ones I'm going to serve later. No. All right. And what we're going to do is flour, if you will, in quotes, the inside of the mold with your... Oh, yeah. Right? Okay, so that way it'll keep it from sticking right here. Oh my gosh, I forgot an ingredient. I don't see it here. Jeff, can I borrow one of your Viagra, please? You know, it's a little secret we're using now. And you just put one right into the middle of the souffle. You don't even have to go. And by golly, they just come right up and... So, let me fill the souffle mold. All right, we'll put it in there like this. This is enough for 2. And fill it right up to the top. I don't know who decided that you weren't supposed to fill a souffle bowl up. And try not to get too much on the edge because, again, it tends to stick. Put this away. And now we pop it into a 375-degree oven. 20 minutes, 25 minutes or so. Right here. While that's cooking, you know, I think it's about time for a glass of bubbly, don't you? This is thirsty work. All right. Nothing like a little glass. That's what you serve with a romantic breakfast in bed, for sure. A glass of bubbly. Oh, oh, that sound. All right. Put a little here. Put a little here. And just to make up for that last joke, we'll put it right over here.
Thank you, John.
And by now, I hope the souffle is ready to go. So we'll take our towel here. Ooh. Voila! You could sprinkle a little cheese on top if you wanted before it went out. Any questions at all on the souffles? Now's the time.
What kind of cheeses can you use?
Well, you could certainly use goat cheese, cheddar, the hard cheeses mostly, because the softer cheeses like brie and everything are a little bit more difficult. You'd have to change the formula slightly to make up for that extra butterfat. Not that there's anything wrong with butterfat, but a triple cream cheese, for instance, might alter your recipe just a little bit.
Jacques, for those of us who don't really know how to use an oven, how can we tell when that's done, actually?
That's a very good question. You can take, while it's in the oven, I won't take it back over there, but while it's in the oven, you can just take a toothpick on the side, not from the top, so you get to the center, and if the toothpick comes out clean, it's about ready. I mean, some people like it a little bit more moist in the center, but that's a really good way to tell. And if your oven is at home is like mine, it's off. You know? So here we have them calibrated every 6 weeks. So get a little thermometer, a little kitchen thermometer, and then you'll be sure of it. But that's a way to tell. You know, back in the good old days when men were men and women were glad of it, we just went over and put our hand in the oven and go, oh, that's about right. But you were used to it. You were used to doing it that way. Now it's all electronic and digitized, but the cooking isn't any better. It's not the stove. It's the cook behind the stove. That's the way. Thank you very much. Our second two for tonight, romantic breakfast or brunch, is a seafood, my seafood version, if you will, of the classic Eggs Benedict. Smoked fish takes the place of the traditional Canadian bacon, and I have a few other twists and turns on here, but the main ingredient, the thing you really must have, is a nice hollandaise sauce, which we don't want to make too far in advance. We want to make it fresh, and this is not hard to make either. But it's, you know, a few tricks here and there which you have to be aware of. So first of all, we're going to take our bowl, and I'm going to put in two egg yolks, which someone has already, cracked for you. Wearing only an apron, of course. And we're going to mix that and put it over a pot of simmering water. Actually, here in the kitchen, again, manly chefs and womenly chefs, just put it directly on the burner. Don't try this at home, especially with two yolks. It's actually easier to make like 30 eggs than to make the two eggs. And this is going to heat up here right now, so I'm just going to quickly grab a towel here. Excuse me. What you want to do is cook it over your bain-marie in your water bath. Do it in an 8 pattern. It really fluffs up the eggs and incorporates as much air in there to make a light and airy hollandaise. Now, the trick is, and you can move it back and forth this way, is not to scramble the eggs, just to merely cook them till we get a fine ribbon, and it won't take long with just two eggs in there. A couple of minutes, actually. Again, this is where you get real hot and sweaty, and that person that you've invited into the kitchen, you've got everything else done ahead of time. You have your eggs poached, you have your seafood ready to go, your bottle of bubbly at the ready. And you just make your hollandaise and finish the dish. That's what two for tonight, I think, is all about, is to make that dish for that special person, but you don't want to spend all day at it. I mean, she'll fall asleep before you get her into one of the other rooms. All right, this is about cooked enough. If I can show you, you just have a nice ribbon right here. That's all you do. And we'll put it here in the center. And I have taken a stick of butter. You think that's enough for two people?
Yeah.
What's wrong with butter?
Nothing.
Absolutely not. You want the butter to be slightly tepid, but I need to show you a little trick. We're going to pour the warm butter into the cooked egg yolks. If you don't happen to have a scantily clad assistant to hold the bowl for you, take a damp towel and put it in the center, and the bowl will stay still, hopefully. Another trick we used to do when I was in Paris is you did 40 or 50 eggs, you know, 20 pounds of butter. If you take the butter and very slowly pour it in there. That's going to take you all day. So you take a little cold water to dilute the eggs. This doesn't hurt anything, but it allows you to pour the butter in hotter and faster. So we'll whisk that in there. Now, you know, eggs have been maligned for the last 30 years, but I think now we know. That was in the last millennium. In the new millennium, we've discovered that eggs are one of the most nutritious things on the planet, one of the best things for you, and as a matter of fact, all other proteins are measured against eggs. So have an egg or two every day. Good for you. All right, we can argue whether you should have a stick of butter or not with it. We won't talk about that. A little butter. All right, you see how this emulsifies the butter and the eggs? You form an emulsion. Now, what you better know also is how to fix it if it breaks. If the butter is too hot and the hollandaise separates, you put a little cold water, or even better, an ice cube. You take a little ice cube and put it in there and do like that, and you'll bring it back up. Now, if the hollandaise gets too cold, you put a little hot water in there and do the same thing. Now, we're going to finish the hollandaise. I'm going to put a drop of lemon juice, okay? A pinch of cayenne pepper. There you are. And a little regular salt and pepper. And, of course, we better taste it to make sure it's formidable, magnifique. My friends, I remember 1935. No, I really don't, honestly. I love hollandaise, and of course, it's the basis of béarnaise, saucheron, all your wonderful classic emulsions. Just be careful not to make it too far ahead. The eggs are not completely cooked, but you're going to make it fresh and ready to go. And don't let it linger too long over the stove or around there. Besides, you want to get on with the business of the day. To finish our eggs benedict or our seafood benedict, I have made a potato and apple pancake. Now, one tip on the apples. Buy what they call eating apples. Because a cooking apple is just an apple that no one will eat, so they'll sell you as a cooking apple. A Golden Delicious or a Granny Smith, and there are many wonderful apples. Get those, they hold up a little bit better. I don't have time today to show you. What we're going to do is saute the apples and put some grated potatoes in there. Now, I've made this ahead of time. Let me borrow this right here. And let's put our final dish together. We have the apple and potato pancakes here. Put our serving dish, oops, over here. Let me just move this to the side. I'm going to put it in the center of your serving platter, like so. Then I will take a little smoked salmon to replace your Canadian bacon. Set it there in the center. Then I will take the poached egg, which, again, use one of these stainless steel poachers. They're very easy. You get great results with them. And you can make them a little bit ahead. You can build this whole thing and then put it in the oven for a few minutes just to warm it up. It doesn't have to be hot, hot. All right, now we're going to take some smoked mussels, a couple of smoked scallops, and you can do as we do. You can have these things air freighted to you. Hey, I had this flown in for you, honey. Think about it. Think about it. It's a gift. Remember, preparing that romantic meal for someone is a gift. And they're going to show you their appreciation, I promise you. We're going to put a couple of shrimp, if you like them. And I have an unusual ingredient. It is smoked hamachi. It's a hamachi being a kingfish, a tuna-like fish. It replaces the bacon, if you like. Let's just put that on the side like that. And we're going to take our hollandaise. And if you have a little extra hollandaise, which you will, you might. Enough said? Enough said? And now, the traditional topping, truffles. Now, I know all of you have in your refrigerator, next to the champagne, truffles and caviar at hand at all times. I just know you do. So you have the, you know, a nice slice of truffle there. Or, since it's seafood, why not just go for the caviar? A little beluga caviar. You know, you don't have to buy a lot of caviar. An ounce is impressive. It's expensive. But only an ounce shows that you care. You want the best for that special someone. Here's your seafood Benedict. This is a classic, just like the two of you. Thank you very much. Our third dish is an apple and Roquefort tart, where we're using the finest Roquefort cheese and a delicious apple. You know, the apple has been a symbol of lust and love throughout mankind's history. You know, the old story about Eve tempting Adam with her wiles, taking the bite of the apple and then giving it to him, and a piece got stuck in his throat. From where men especially have their symbol of their fall forever, the Adam's apple. See, it's the woman's fault. It says so in the good book. I mean, who am I to go against that? This dish was inspired by a return trip to France. I used to work at La Rôtisserie Périgourdine in Paris, Place Saint-Michel. Went into the restaurant years after I left and ordered a chausson, which is a turnover. And got it, and it was delicious. But the problem is that when the cheese is wrapped up in the puff dough, it tends to keep the dough from getting crisp. It's soggy. So occasionally you get a great idea after a few bottles of wine in Paris. When I returned home, we decided to make an apple and roquefort tart, that classic combination, fruit and cheese, but put it on a disc, if you will, of puff pastry, rather than wrapping it in the puff pastry. Now, puff pastry is a little bit of time consuming to make. You can certainly buy a nice product, but you could use toasted country bread or a brioche as a substitute, but you didn't hear it from me. All right? What we do is take our puff dough, here our discs of puff dough, and what I like to do to keep them from puffing too much is to put another tray on top, all right? And you bake it for about 10 minutes and then take the tray off and you'll end up with a nice disc of dough, just like this, all right? Now we need to take our apples. Now our pan's good and hot here. A little butter. What's wrong with butter?
Why not use olive oil?
Olive oil. Well, that's a very good question. Why not use olive oil? Because it just doesn't have the flavor. Then it might sound like an Italian dish. You know what I'm saying? All right. We're going to take butter and let it brown a little bit and put in some sugar or evaporated cane juice. This will work. You want to caramelize the butter. And it doesn't matter. You could put the sugar in first, or the sucanat, then the butter. Either way, they're both going to caramelize very nicely. We're going to take our apple wedges and put them inside and just toss them just to get a nice caramel color and just cook them for a minute or two just to soften them up because, remember, you're going to heat it back up in the oven. All right. You can prepare this completely ahead. You cook the dough. You saute the apples. You arrange them on there. Put the cheese on top and have it ready and just pop it in the oven. Easy to do and just a great combination. Now I'm going to take the apples that we've already allowed to cool and saute and put them around the tart, prepared tart or bread or brioche, whichever you'd like to do. You know, a savory pie crust, just a simple pie crust, just flat, will work. That's another good substitute for the puff pastry. We just happen to have a lot of puff pastry around here, so we want to use these. It's probably one of our most often requested items as an appetizer. And it's great for a brunch, too. It's a dessert, but it's not a dessert. It's sweet, but it has that great Roquefort flavor here. I have some already put over here. Now, I must, you know, give you a little lesson on blue cheese and Roquefort. Real Roquefort from France. There's also Stilton. All right, it's from England, but we'll use it. Some really good blue cheeses. But if you just use plain old blue cheese, that's not the best. You want the best for that sweetie of yours. Because, you know, if you do an apple and blue cheese tart, that's $1.75. If it's a tarte aux pommes et roquefort, well, that's $9.95. Don't laugh. This is Washington. It's how we all got here. All right? Now, we're going to take our prepared tart, and when you're ready to go, put it on a sheet pan and pop it in the oven. And all you do is heat it for 3 or 4 minutes or put it on the broiler and just slightly melt the cheese. While that's going, I think we should probably have another glass of champagne. Don't you think? Yeah. All right. Actually, if you're the chef, somebody ought to keep them coming for you. A little bubbly. The perfect brunch beverage. And you already have some. Let me put some right over here.
Thank you.
Enjoy it. All right, our tart, I hope, is ready by now. Okay. And there you are. Let me put that champagne over here. All right. Get our serving plate. And we'll take our tart and set it right over here. Now, you could garnish this with some fruit, some grapes, for instance. Would be nice, a fig or something like that. And you have a great ending to a romantic brunch. Listen, do this, and they'll be crazy about you forever. Cook for that special someone. They'll show their appreciation. Thank you very much.
The people,